Good morning. How are you guys doing today? Good. Oh, good. Sorry. We were kind of loud. Stand up with us. Let's just worship Him together.
Hi. worship you, God. You know, I'm reminded of the scripture when Jesus was coming into, he was going in somewhere and he was in a donkey and they started singing, Hosanna, Hosanna. And some of the folks said, tell these people to be quiet. And what was said is that if they do not praise me, the rocks will start crying out. One thing, I made a decision a long time ago that I'm not going to allow a rock to take my place where it comes to worshiping my God. Amen? So, I will be undignified. I will do whatever it takes to worship my God. Amen? Come on, let's give Him praise this morning.
Let's just go to Him in prayer. God, we just thank You this morning, God, that we can come to You, surrendering all to You, God. We thank You that even through our brokenness and sometimes our ugliness, God, You love us anyway. That You are our Father and we are precious to You, precious sons and precious daughters, God. We thank You for it, God. We come to You right now with our needs, Father. We come to You right now with anything, Father, that we might be struggling with. God, if there be physical needs in this room, God, right now we hand them over to You. If you're struggling physically, church, I just encourage you to raise your hands. Lift your hands up to Him this morning right now as I pray. God, we just pray that You would touch anybody, God, that is struggling, God. You would replace pain, God, with comfort, God. We trust in You this morning. God, I lift up every financial need to You this morning. God, anyone who doesn't know where their next bills are going to get paid, God, how You're going to come through, God, we lay it at Your feet right now. We give it to You. We know that You are able. God, I lift up every emotional need, God, every person here who may feel lonely or broken or afraid right now, God, we pray that You would bring supernatural comfort, God, because we know that that's what You want to do for us, God, and we just lay ourselves down before You. We lift up every marriage before You, God. We pray that You would strengthen us, God, as husbands and wives who ask You to come and be the center of our relationships, God. We give it over to You. Our families, God, we lift up every child to You, God. Every teenager and young adult who's represented by a parent in this room, God. We just lay them at Your feet, God, surrendering all to You, God, knowing that You are good and You are faithful and that they are Yours and not ours, God. We just thank You and praise You for what You are doing in this place already, God. Thank You and praise You for what You want to continue to do, God. We are open to You this morning, God. We pray that You would come and speak to us, God, where You want to, God. Draw our hearts closer to Yours, God. Make us better this morning, God. That's what we desire. We love You and praise You. We lift Your name up higher than any other name, God. Jesus, You are holy and worthy, faithful God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
My heart to
Hallelujah.
You. You are.
Yes, Jesus.
Come on, church.
Yes, You are.
So come.
Glad you guys are here this morning to worship with us and be with us. Go ahead and have a seat as we watch this video together.
On a brisk October eve, these titans of confection gather once again in the pursuit of greatness. These gentle giants design, decorate, and even test the achievability and safety of each game. And they do this all in the pursuit of one noble goal: to give joy to children from all over their community. Throughout the centuries, generations have witnessed great feats of dedication in the church, but none have ever been so committed to the tooth decay of its youngsters. Many of these players not only put their reputation on the line, but they also risk their lives to create a spectacle the crowd will be pleased with. The infamous Apple Bob, a crowd favorite for years, was almost banned this year due to the near career-ending accident for little Bobby Meadows when the petite Gala apples were substituted with oversized Granny Smiths. That's why safety is their greatest concern. Because he ate more candy than he gave away last year, Tony the Grizzly Adams was asked to take one for the team and man the pumpkin carving station. He reminds everyone that this is not for the faint of heart. Feeling like she had something to prove following last year's failed game of Name That Prophet, Bev Stevens throws a Hail Mary this year, only to be intercepted by her straight-laced husband. Fortunately, the youth leader is always a team player. Prior to the event start time, the crowd reaches anticipation levels of near hysteria. They can no longer be contained. It's all about the food, fellowship, and fun. Who are we kidding? It's all about the candy.
Well, the Harvest Fest is upon us. It's almost here, coming up at the end of the month, October 29th on a Saturday. It's going to be a blast, so I hope that many of you will make a time to be there. You'll bring all the kids. You'll have all the wonderful costumes. We always have such a good time with so many games and activities. But now is the time for us as a church to begin to plan those fun games and activities and everything that's going to happen. So there's a flyer in your bulletin. If you want to be a part of serving and helping that night be amazing, please sign up on the flyer in the bulletin. We are going to need like an all hands on deck kind of show up to make this thing awesome. We normally have a lot of kids from the community, and it's just such a great chance to bless them and make sure they have fun when they come to church. Amen? I'm excited about that. And I don't know if it really is all about the candy for the kids, but for me, I'm ready for the candy. That's where it lands for me. So I'm just saying, if you give my kids candy, I replace it with healthy things. My wife replaces it with healthy things, and I take the candy back to my office. And that's what happens. It's true. It's absolutely true. You guys think I'm joking. This is real. If you don't know me, my name is Josh. I'm one of the teaching pastors here at the church. And I'm so glad to be able to welcome you all today. I would love to draw your attention to the bulletin you received when you came in, inside of which there is a Connect card. I would love it, absolutely love it, if all of you would mark whether it's your first time here, your second time, or maybe you're a regular attender or a member at the church. Let us know you're here today. That helps us keep track of things. But especially if it is your very first time, we would love it if you would mark that it's your first time guest and put your name on there. And if you're willing to put your address, we want to send you a gift in the mail, something to just bless you and let you know that we're so glad that you came to be with us here at Innovation Church this morning. Again, welcome. It's so great to have all of you here. I want to just bring your attention to a few things happening this week and throughout the next couple of weeks here at the church. On Tuesday, we have our MOPS ministry meeting at 10 a.m. That's the mothers of preschoolers. So if you fit into that category, you are more than welcome and invited to come out and be here. Again, that's Tuesday, 10 a.m. And Wednesday, we have a lot of different activities happening for the whole family, starting at 6:30 with youth going to Outbreak. That's grades 7 and up. We have iKids for elementary age starting at 7 o'clock. We have all the adult classes. We're starting some new ones this Wednesday. We're going to have a new Bible discussion group about serving within the church, which is going to be great. It's a 3-week-long class, so it's really short, real easy to attend. We'd love to have you out. There's also going to be a new class called Debate, starting this Wednesday, which is about 4 weeks long. It's all about overcoming offense in our lives and refusing to give in to bitterness and frustration. Amen? Yeah, I think all of us need that. If you haven't been there, it is worth it. It's an incredible time. And of course, we have Pastor Charles leading the core class going through 1 John right now, which has been a wonderful time. And I think they're coming up on being about halfway through, maybe. I don't know. I'm losing track of time. But those things are all happening Wednesday at 7, so you're welcome to come and be invited and grow continually in your faith and also closer together. These are smaller groups, a chance to build some relationships within the church, which is just absolutely vital to being connected and feeling like this is family. Amen? So that's what we want. I hope to see you there. A couple things coming in the weeks ahead. Saturday, October the 15th, we have the Walk for Freedom happening over in Stroudsburg. This is an awareness walk as we're raising money for a ministry that combats human trafficking throughout the country and also around the world. But this is a big issue, and we're trying to bring awareness to that. Often it goes overlooked in America, but it is a huge issue here and hiding under a lot of huge events and things that we all take part in. There's a very ugly side to what's happening with human trafficking, so I please consider being a part of that. Again, that's October the 15th, the Walk for Freedom. Then we have a night here at the church, a missions night, on Monday, October the 17th at 7 o'clock. You're all invited. We're going to have the band out. We're going to be worshiping. We're going to be praying, and we're going to be specifically focused on praying over all the missionaries of our church, praying over their needs, what they're going through, sharing some of their stories with you, everything that they've given to us. That's our night to bring it to you and for us as a church family to lift them up in prayer together and hear about them and celebrate what they're doing all around the world. We celebrate missionaries pretty much everywhere. So that's a fun night on Monday, October the 17th. You're all welcome to be there. I hope you'll mark it on your calendar. And of course, just a quick additional reminder for the Harvest Fest. Fill out that flyer. Let us know if you're going to be there to help. We need help, right? Otherwise, guess who sets up? Me and John. That's who it lands on. Me and John, young pastors. See, we're like professional table movers. I don't know if you know that. That's actually a part of your training when you go to Bible school, folding and unfolding thousands and thousands of tables. That's what we do. I just want to tell you one other thing because I shared it with First Service and I thought you guys would want to hear it too. It has nothing to do with anything, but I thought it was really cute. My daughter Emery is she's sick, not feeling great, so she's just conked out on Allison right now. But here's the thing. Emery gets terrified when anyone ever claps near her. Like her whole body just gets tight and she looks around, she doesn't know what's happening. And this is the absolute worst environment for that to exist. I mean, you guys clap for absolutely everything. And so after every song, after every prayer, even right now, your people are torturing her. Those of you who think you're funny, you just tortured my daughter, but she's over there just shrinking away, but keep her in prayer. Also, I'll mention Pastor Charles is a little sick right now. He's under the weather. He's recovering from strep throat. He's barely been able to speak these last few days, so that's a blessing, but it's been, no, I'm just kidding. He's really, that was good, right? That was so good. But we're going to keep him in our thoughts and our prayers. He's not here today, but we love him. And if he's watching from home, we love you. Hope you feel better. We're going to watch a video real quick together as we get ready to hear the Word of God. Amen? All right.
Some to Jesus I surrender, some to him I freely give. I will sometimes love and trust him, in his presence occasionally live. I surrender some, I surrender some to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Well, I surrender some. New series we're starting today. I'm excited about it. I'm thrilled to be able to bring this first message to you this morning. I don't know if anybody else thought of it, but I am convinced that the person singing in that video is Joe Kroll. It just makes sense. That's got to be Joe or his cousin or something, but I'm not sure. He swears it's not. I don't believe it. It's so good to be with you guys. I want to start this morning with a quick question. Do you say vase or do you say vase? Oh, a little bit mixed. Mostly vase, though. Okay. All right, a few vase in there, a few elegant. Yeah, okay. I get it. I heard a story, and I wanted to tell it to you, and it involves a vase because it was a very expensive kind of antique vase, and I think if it's expensive, it's got to be a vase. It can't be an expensive vase. That's like, you know, a vase is just, whatever, you know, it's not a big deal. This was an expensive vase. This was something that really mattered to the family, and it's a family with young children, as most of my stories go, but these were not mine. This is someone else's child, a little boy somehow got his hands on his parents' expensive vase, and he was playing with it, putting stuff in it, all this fun stuff, until eventually, of course, his hand got stuck inside the vase. And he can't get out. No matter what they do, he can't get out. I mean, they're putting butter on his wrist. They're doing all kinds of stuff. The dad's pulling on his arm. They can't get his hand out of this vase. And so it's becoming a real issue. The dad is there, and he's starting to think, I'm going to have to break this thing. I'm going to have to break the vase to be able to get his arm out. And that's a huge deal because this is worth money. This is money. And if you have a little kid who's about to ruin something in your house that costs real money, that's not a fun moment. I don't know if that hits close to home for any of you. That's like every other 5 minutes in my house right now. So this is very potent for me. But they're thinking, we're going to have to break it. So the dad, in one last, you know, effort, looks the son in the eye, says, look at me. You got to really look at me. Pay attention, because little ones, they, you know, they're all over the place. Look at me. Look in my eyes. I need you to do this with your hand, okay? Open your hand, make sure your fingers are pointed down, put your thumb in, and pull it out of the vase. You can do this. You got it in, you can take it out. You know you can do it. And the little boy looks at his dad and says, Dad, I can't open my hand. If I do that, I'll lose the dime. Right? And this little kid is holding on to a dime inside of like a priceless vase that his family cherishes and wants, and they're about to break it just to find that their son was in for the dime. Of course, this is the idea, this is the concept of I surrender some. This is the idea of we like to hold on to things in our lives, don't we? We like to hold on to the shiny dimes and all the little wealths that the world has to offer. You see, we are the little boy. I know we don't like to be the little boy, but we're the little boy. We're all silly and ridiculous, and we can't pay attention, and our father has to get our attention and say, just let go. Just open your hand, and I can bring you freedom. I have something bigger in mind. And that's what this series is really about surrendering all, not just some. And I know it's a funny idea and we'll keep playing with it, but these are some really important messages. They are essential for me in my life. I pray, I trust that they are going to be essential for you in your life and that God will be challenging us to continue to grow deeper as we really look into letting go of everything, surrendering all that we have so that we can trade the little dimes of this world for the fullness and the riches of a life of the freedom that God has to offer. I'm very excited about it, and we're going to be looking into chapter 13 of Matthew. Of course, Jesus has a lot to say about surrender, about surrendering everything we have, and so in Matthew chapter 13, there are a lot of parables, quite a few, and we're going to be looking at two of them. They're the two shortest of all the parables, only about two sentences each, so it's very, very simple, but there is a lot of depth. And these verses are going to launch us in to this new series and this concept of total surrender. The passage comes out of Matthew 13, verse 44. If you want to read along with me, they'll be on the screen. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. And when a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. And when he found one of great value, he went away, sold everything he had, and bought that pearl. So this is the idea, this is the concept, but we want to start our morning off just giving everything to the Lord. And so if you would bow your heads in prayer, let's start there. Father, we love you. We thank you so very much for your word, and we anticipate that it will speak directly to our hearts and minds in the next several minutes, Lord. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear, that we would continue forward on this journey of life as you grow us to look less like ourselves and more like your Son, Jesus. That is our heart's desire. Lead us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, the kingdom of heaven is like... Jesus starts both of these parables, and that was two. I know they were so short, but that's two little mini parables. And he starts both of them off with the phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like. In the first, of course, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that has been stumbled upon, that was just randomly found. In the second, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for a pearl of great price, who's been looking and longing for this thing that is really going to set him up and make everything okay in his life, the desire that he has wanted. So whether you just stumble upon it, whether you're looking for it, whatever the case may be, it's very important that we understand that Jesus is relating this to the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God being something so big, so vast, so beyond us that we can barely comprehend the idea. This is everything that God has for us, his kingdom. This is life empowered by the Spirit of God, life living under his anointing, life full of freedom and joy and peace. This is all that he has for you and for me, summed up in two tiny little parables. In other words, Jesus is telling us, pay attention. He's saying, I know someday people are going to write this down as three little verses, and you'll be tempted to skim over it. You'll be tempted to read it quickly and get on to the next parable. Jesus is saying, stop, pause. The kingdom of heaven is like these things. What God has in store for me, what God has in store for you, we can learn about right here in these very few words. And so we're going to look at the very first one, the parable of the buried treasure. The buried treasure. I want to give you a little bit of context regarding what was happening with Jesus and around this parable. He was speaking to a very large crowd, such a large crowd, in fact, that he got onto a boat in the lake, so basically creating for himself a stage, as if you were all surrounding me and you couldn't wait to hear what I was going to say, which I know happens all the time. You guys are so anxious to be here, and I had to break apart and stand up on a boat so everyone could see me and hear me. That's what's happening with Jesus. They want to listen. They want to hear. This was the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Lake of Gennesaret, or also known as the Lake Tiberias, different names for different cultures all existing in the same time period. And Jesus gets up on the boat and he says, the kingdom of heaven is like the hidden treasure in the field. And when a man found that treasure, he hid it again so no one else would find it, and he went and bought that field. He bought that field so he could own the treasure, so it would be his. I'm not sure about any of you, but as a child, I was a treasure hunter. That was my occupation. I woke up every morning thinking, what will I find today? Where will I go? Because as a kid, you're pretty sure that under every rock exists money. Under everything, and I don't know about you, but I had the junk drawer in my home. Did you all have junk drawers? My mother is so clean and neat. If you've ever been to her house, I hope you all get a chance to go and visit with her and Pastor, but she is... it's immaculate. I mean, it's amazing. It almost frustrates me how clean it always is, but there is the junk drawer. And when I was a kid, I would search through the junk drawer in hope of finding pennies and nickels and dimes and the dollar bill, the coveted dollar bill, or even greater. And of course, if I found them, they quickly disappeared into my pocket. But then I'd be running around the neighborhood, going everywhere I could, looking for treasure. Even if it was imaginary treasure, whatever the case may be, I would find something, and that something would become a sword, or a magic this, or a magic that, and all of a sudden I'm in a world of make-believe and playing and having fun. Do you guys do that? None of you did that. You're all so boring. None of you had fun when you were kids? Oh my goodness, I loved to play those kinds of games, but see, you all, you're sophisticated. You are a part of adult sophisticated society, and in adult sophisticated society, we know better than that. We know better than to think that there's treasure hidden everywhere. We understand that that's a game for children. Yet here Jesus is saying that a man just randomly finds treasure in the middle of a field. Is this just a make-believe story? Is this something that he's just trying to make a point? What's really happening? Well, I believe that these moments actually occur. As a matter of fact, just to prove that treasure is out there and to rekindle your inner child, have any of you ever heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? Any of you? So the Dead Sea Scrolls are the actual most full and best written account we have of the ancient texts of Scripture. Many other texts were found, but they did incredible things archaeologically. That's not a word. But based on the archaeology and studying these texts, I mean, this was a huge find for the church and believers of the Bible, a huge treasure trove of ancient texts. They were found by a boy in Israel who threw a rock. That rock went into a cave, and he heard the sound of breaking clay. He hit a clay jar. And so they said, what was that noise? They investigated and found the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's ultimate treasure hunting 101. Like, that's awesome. So just start throwing rocks everywhere. Like, you'll get something good. There's a guy in Florida, and you know treasure hunters are always going down into the Caribbean and stuff like that, but they find stuff. There was a guy in Florida who found an entire ship, a sunken 17th century Spanish ship, full of silver and gold. Full of silver and gold. We should all be searching for these treasures. That's what I wanted when I was little, and I never found anything. All I found were nickels and dimes in a junk drawer. But these things are out there. There was a farmer in England who was plowing his field, and he hit something hard down under the soil, and he found a container full of priceless silver dishes dating back from when the Romans lived in England. Such awesome stuff. I want to find something like that. If any of you find something, make sure you point it in my direction. I'll be there. That's actually funny. I hadn't thought of it until right now. I don't know if my sister Heather is in here. She's probably out with Hezekiah. But my brother-in-law, Matt, he does geocaching. Do any of you geocache? Does anyone know what geocaching is? We got one, two, a few. Some of you cool young people. Yeah, and Dana, you're a cool young person too. You're in there. Geocaching is this thing. You get an app on your phone and it gives you coordinates and you go treasure hunting. And other people hide caches all over the place. And there's one on our property. I bet none of you knew that. There's one over here in front of the church offices. Either way, I just want you guys to be treasure hunters. That's the real point of this message, is that you will all end up just going out, throwing rocks and finding treasures. But in this parable, the treasure's hidden in this field. And we don't know who put it there. We don't know why it's there. We don't know how long it's been there. It doesn't tell us any of that. But if we look into the culture that Jesus was talking to, we actually discover something very interesting. This wasn't out of the question. This wasn't like me saying to you that if you throw a rock, you're going to find treasure. You guys are all saying, Josh, stop being ridiculous. That joke is dead. Just stop it. But Jesus was saying, this was real. There's a guy, and he just found treasure in a field. Because in that time period, and in around Palestine, that was a war-ravaged nation, a war-ravaged people. And it had been for generation after generation after generation. There was captivity after captivity, different ruling powers, which meant a lot, sadly, of tragedy, a lot of death, and a lot of changing of hands in regard to land ownership. And the people of that time, guess what they did with their valuables? They buried them to hide them. They kept them safe by hiding them in the ground. That was a common occurrence. We actually see it in one of the other parables that Jesus told. You guys know the parable of the talents. It's a kind of money. To some, Jesus gave five, another two, to one, he gave one. That last one who only had one talent, what did he do with it? He hid it in the ground. He buried it. So we even see right here from the cultural context that this kind of stuff was regular. And because of all of the death and because of all that changing of hands regard to who owned the fields and all the different things that could happen, if you died while something was buried in your field, which happened more often than maybe we would think, all of a sudden there are hidden treasures. So there are things scattered all throughout the fields of this time period and this generation. It's a very interesting thing. So when Jesus says there was a man digging, working in the field, and he found a treasure, everyone kind of understood that. Everyone kind of had an idea that these things were out there, that some poor soul must have lost their treasure and someone else has now found it, and that's great. We don't know if the man was a hired hand. We don't know if he was renting the field. We don't know anything about that. But whatever the case, eventually we know he hit something. He found something in the earth. He dug it out, and he was so excited about what he found that he was willing to give everything to gain that treasure. Now, I'll tell you this because I can hear some of you are really wrestling with a question. There's a concern, and I know some of you have it. I'm being really facetious. I know none of you are thinking this way. But there is a concern that some people have with this parable, that this guy who found the treasure, that he was really just a thief, that it wasn't his treasure. He found it. He shouldn't have deceived someone, bought the land and taken it. And so why is Jesus telling us a parable, relating it to the kingdom of heaven, this beautiful, all-encompassing thing that we all strive to live in and be a part of? Why is Jesus using someone who's living unethically and potentially stealing to do this? Well, I'm very glad that you guys are concerned about this. I'm glad that that was a question that you've been thinking about. But it's not really an issue. Believe it or not, this is an actual rabbinic law from that time period. It states that if a man finds scattered fruit or money, it belongs to the finder. So essentially, the Jewish people lived by finders keepers. That's what we're discovering. That's what we learned. So why they all thought it was a good idea to hide their things all over the place makes no sense. But that's what we're looking at. That's the picture. But it doesn't seem as if there's anything unethical happening here. The guy is not a thief. And believe it or not, if you really think it through to the logical conclusion, if the guy wanted to buy the field and there was treasure hidden there, the owner of the field would never sell his treasure. So obviously he didn't know about it. It didn't belong to him. So there's nothing negative happening, and we can move forward. On the same page? I know that was bothering you guys. Thank you for indulging me in that. But I'm sure that the man's friends and family began to get concerned. I'm sure they began to think, because, you know, he has this treasure. He doesn't want to tell anyone about the treasure, but he knows that now to get the treasure, he needs to buy the field. In order to buy the field, he had to get rid of everything. He sold everything he had. He sold his possessions so he could get this field. That's risky business. Everybody around him was probably saying, there's nothing special about this field. Why are you selling everything? Why are you offering so much? What are you doing? This is a bad, bad decision. It's not going to pay off. And everyone's looking at him saying, this just isn't right. But we need to be careful here not to lose sight of the main point of the parable. And I realize that I haven't actually told you the main point of the parable just yet. So listen, this is the main point of the parable. It's so simple that I really don't even need to tell it to you. It simply is what it says, that a man found something so valuable that he was willing to sell everything he had to get it. That's the point. That's what Jesus is trying to get us to understand. Really deep, right? That a man sold everything. He found something so valuable that he'd sell everything to get that treasure, to get that valued item. So hang on to that, hold it in the back of your brains, because I want to look into the second parable, and then we're going to make these things connect. The second parable is that of the fine pearl, or the pearl of great price. It's referred to several different ways, but here we see what is actually another vision of the kingdom of God. We see Jesus saying, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. And when he found one of great value, he went away, sold everything he had, and bought it. So by itself, this story is very similar to the first. We see a lot of parallels, a lot of similarities, almost kind of a mirror, just with some differences. And so we see the same commitment in each person, the same desire to put the same amount of worth onto what they're getting, to sell everything. It's very similar. Each man wanted that which was valued and was willing to give everything to get it. It's important for us to understand, again, to look at the context and see where pearls were and what pearls meant to the first century church and in and around that era. We actually can see from the writings of Paul that people were already using pearls and decorating themselves with pearls, because he said in 1 Timothy 2:9 that he wanted Christian women to not wear pearls. He said you should dress modestly. I know we don't typically think of pearls as immodest, but he says not with braided hair or gold or pearls or expensive clothing. And what he's getting at is that there was a trend of saying, I am of status. I am a big deal. And if I'm a big deal, I need everyone around me to know that I'm a big deal. And you see these pearls in my hair? Yes, of course you see my pearls. I'm better than you are. And it's a pride issue. It's a pride of the heart issue. And of course, so Paul is saying, we don't want that. That's not the Christian mindset. That's not who we are. It's actually known by historians that the Roman emperors would take pearls, have them slowly dissolved over time in vinegar, and then that dissolved solution put into their wine so they could drink pearls. Talk about wealth squandered. I am such a big deal. It's like the guy that, you know, lights his cigar with the $100 bill. You know what I mean? They're literally drinking pearls. It's ridiculous. But we can see in the culture that there was a desire then for these pearls, and they had a sense of status related to them. So within the first century church, they of course would have been worth a ton of money, and they would have been in very great demand, similar to now, you know? However, merchants from Israel had a pretty hard time with this because there aren't a lot of pearls in Israel. Not a lot of options. So they would have to travel. They would have to journey. They would be merchants seeking out these incredible finds, these incredible purchases that they could then make money on. They'd have to go maybe to the Red Sea. Not too far, but you know, slim pickings. Maybe they'd have to go down to the Persian Gulf. Ultimately, to really find the best of the best, some may even have to travel to the coasts of India. to find these pearls of great price. Whatever the case may be, we don't really know from the story because we have limited information, but we can get an understanding for what it might have looked like and the world of a merchant might have been like there in the first century. So the man portrayed by Jesus here is the merchant. He's looking for the fine pearl. We don't know if he's traveled far. We don't know any of that, but it certainly isn't out of the question. But certainly, when he found this pearl, he recognized the opportunity of a lifetime. When he found this pearl, when he saw it, he realized this is something special. This is worth everything. And so what he did is he began to assess what he had, evaluate what he was worth, and he realized, I can't buy this unless I sell everything. And so he did. He began to sell all of his possessions. He sold all the land that he owned. He sold all the other goods that he worked with as a merchant just to get the pearl of great price. Now, Jesus was very strategic in the use of a pearl here for this. I love it because we can find such depth in the simple words that Jesus said. But the pearl is the wonderfully perfect picture for the kingdom of heaven. I say that because the pearl, of all of the other precious jewels and gems and other things that we as humans tend to value, the pearl is unaffected by the hands of the craftsman. When you find the pearl, it is the pearl. It is in itself perfect. But if you find diamonds or you find ruby, you find all these other things, there are craftsmen who will cut them and form them into what we desire and what we want to have happen. But the pearl itself is perfect when found. That's what we want. As a matter of fact, if you cut the pearl, what happens? It loses all of its value. It's ruined. Sure, it might be good for some sort of a craft, but that's about it. It's going to lose its value. And the kingdom of heaven is perfectly designed by God. So Jesus knew what he was saying with this analogy, with this illustration, with this story. He wanted us to understand that as the merchant found the pearl of great price, so we find the kingdom of God, and it is to be unaltered. In of itself, it is perfect. It is the beautiful picture of what God has in store for each and every one of us. And if we alter it, all we do is reduce its value. All we do is make it muddy. All we do is ruin what he had already done. So like the man discovering the treasure, like the merchant suddenly finding this pearl, you realize there's a now or never moment. You got to sell everything and buy. You got to get rid of everything, sell everything as fast as you can before someone else gets that pearl, before someone else gets that treasure. And I can imagine, again, the friends and the family members of the merchant, the friends and the family members of the man in the field saying, this is really reckless. This is not wise. This is not a good choice. But we know from the story that they went through with it anyway. And they bought the field. They bought the pearl of great price. And I'm sure that the onlookers were all amazed to realize, well, you just bought a field, but there, now you have treasure? Like, you bought a regular field, and now all of a sudden, yeah, you knew what was going on. He comes out with treasure, and everyone's like, oh, it all makes sense now. Now, obviously, that makes sense, and the people that were telling the merchant, hey, it's not worth it, they finally see that pearl. They see the value of what it was worth. They recognize that this pearl is going to make that merchant infinitely wealthy and rich beyond what he had previously, and it begins to make sense. And they all of a sudden realized that on the outside, what may have looked like a big risk, from the outside, what might have looked like recklessness or potentially dangerous action, from the inside was really just a wise decision. It was a very wise decision. It's not a leap of faith. That's not the kind of teaching Jesus is giving us here. These parables aren't intended to help us in expanding our faith. That's not what this is about. He's not teaching about that. There's no risk involved in buying a field if you know there's treasure under that field. There's no risk involved with buying a pearl if you know that pearl is worth millions and millions of dollars or whatever the case might have been. What they did was sensible. What they did, because they knew what they were in for, was a wise choice. They had stumbled upon items of incredible worth. Even if it was intentional, whether it was unintentional, to bypass them would have been foolish. So get this. In buying the field, in buying the pearl, the two men did not make a sacrifice. That's not what this is about. Sometimes we hear these stories, we hear these parables, and we think, yeah, God desires sacrifice, you know? Sell it all. Sell it all. Get rid of everything, right? But But here's the thing. It's not sacrifice. Because when you sacrifice, you're not getting anything in return. Sacrifice is sacrifice because there is no return. But they knew what they were in for. They knew what they wanted. They knew the treasure existed. They knew the pearl was there. They knew it was worth selling everything because it's not sacrifice. It's surrender. It's surrender. It's recognizing something so valuable, so great, that it's worth all that I have. That's not a sacrifice for me. That's a wise decision to look about and see that Jesus has a kingdom in store, a kingdom of heaven wherein we gain power to live our lives, where we can get the anointing to be ministers of the gospel of peace, where we can live in absolute joy, peace, and love, full of his mercy and grace for the rest of our lives, free from anxiety, free from pain, free from all of that nonsense that comes in a fallen world. To not take that at any cost is foolishness. This is the image. This is the point of the parable. Jesus is saying, if you see something so valuable, it's worth paying the price. It's worth not just surrendering some of what we are, not just surrendering some of what we have, but surrendering all. It's worth everything. Many think that the treasure and the pearl are images of Jesus. And I know you've been around believers, especially new believers, who are so excited, and they say, I have found Jesus. Or skeptics, they'll almost do it in a mocking way. Hey, have you found Jesus yet? Finding Jesus. There's this idea that we find him. And so that's led people to believe that the pearl of great price, the treasure in the field, is actually Jesus. But I would disagree this morning. I wouldn't say that that is what it is. Because keep in mind, it is Jesus here telling the parable who is offering the treasure and the pearl to the people. He's the one giving the story. He's the one talking about it. The truth is, people cannot find Jesus. I don't know if you're aware of that. You don't find Jesus. It's impossible. You don't find him. It's just simply not the way it works. As a matter of fact, in Romans chapter 3, verse 10, we find these words. And this is the moment of the morning where you're very encouraged and lifted up, so pay attention. There is no one who is righteous, not even one. There is no one who has understanding. There is no one who seeks God. Oh, I love those kind of passages. So thank you for being here at Innovation this morning. None of you have any understanding. None of you are righteous. None of you seek God, not even one. We come across passages of scripture like this and we're thinking, what? How is that possible? The point is that Jesus is not lost and needing to be found. Jesus is the one seeking. We don't find him. He finds us. So the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, that is full fellowship with him. That is the everything that he has for you and I. That incredible peace, that incredible love, that incredible power. The kingdom of heaven, that is the treasure. That is the pearl of great price. And who's leading us there? Who's pointing the way? Who's telling us of the parable? Jesus. See, we don't find Jesus. Jesus finds us. And when he does, he says, let me show you this field. I know about this pearl sitting over here. Let me introduce you to the kingdom of God. And it says in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, and these are the words of Jesus, here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. Jesus stands at the door and knocks. We're not out looking for him. He's always standing at your door knocking. There's no great journey needed. There's no great undertaking. He is there. What does it say? Here I am. He's not a hidden God. And so certainly he is not the treasure or the pearl. He's leading us to the kingdom, to life in the kingdom. Consider this. There are travelers and wanderers in our world. People searching with a purpose, kind of like the merchant. Maybe people just wandering and you happen upon things like the man in the field. Whichever case you find yourself in, there's a moment where suddenly you will come face to face with Jesus. Something in your life will speak of who he is. Something will draw you to his presence. Something will open your eyes and put you at a point of decision. And to all who have ears to hear and all who have eyes to see, Jesus says, my beloved, would you surrender all? Would you surrender everything to enter into this kingdom, to enter into the kingdom of heaven, to enter into a life of true freedom? Essentially, God the Father comes down eye to eye with us, just like the Father in that story at the very beginning of this message, with his hand, the Son's hand, stuck in that vase. And the Father goes eye to eye with him, and he says, listen, listen, I want to make sure you're doing this right. Just open your hands. Make sure you open your hand, let go of what you're holding on to, and receive your freedom. Let go of whatever it is, whatever you think has value. Trust me, church, I know. I know there are so many things in this world, and they're all little shiny dimes. Some of them might be big shiny dimes. Maybe it's your savings account. Maybe it's all the great wealth that you've stored up to make sure you are set, you are secure. Maybe it's something much less. I got to be honest, as a parent of three little kids, sometimes the thing I'm really hanging on to is just that moment by the TV at night. And I'm hanging on to that. I know it sounds so silly, but sometimes I'll hold on to that. I know I haven't spent any time with God today. I haven't had time to pray. I haven't had time to focus on him. I haven't had time to meditate on his word or his truth or anything like that. I have been completely devoid. But at the end of the day, I'm tired, and I'm hanging on to that one little bit of entertainment. I'm hanging on to that little bit of disconnection, that little bit of escapism, and I'm holding on to that, just like the little boy holding on to his dime. And God the Father gets down on eye level with us, and he says, just open your fingers. Just let go. When you do, you recognize that that thing that you thought was so valuable, that thing you thought was so important, was nothing but a trap. It was nothing but the mediocrity of this world. And all of a sudden, your eyes become opened to the kingdom of heaven, to the freedom in store for those who live according to God's word, according to God's truth. The words of the song, the incredible hymn, they say, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. He wants us to be free, church. He wants you to experience the life of living in the kingdom of heaven, uninhibited, not bound to this world. True love, true freedom, true joy, true peace. We just have to let go. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you so very much. We are amazed by your word, by your truth, and by the love that you show to us. Lord, I ask that in this moment, right now, that you would speak to each and every one of us, that we would be able to push past our distracting thoughts of what comes next, of what we have to do this afternoon, of that little bit of hunger gnawing at our stomachs. Lord, we take this moment and we focus on you. We focus on your word, on these two simple parables. And we ask, Lord, that you would reveal to us those things that we are still holding on to. Reveal to us how in our lives we have lived saying, I surrender some. Teach us to surrender all. Lord, that we might live in the freedom of your kingdom, that we might live in the fullness of the life that you have in store for us as your sons and as your daughters. We love you, Lord. We long to be with you in your kingdom. We pray these things in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Church, we're going to go back to some worship here in just a few moments. The band is going to come and join me. You guys can actually come on up. But before we get to that point, I want to draw your attention back to your Connect cards. You know, we've done something very strategic here. We've put action steps at the end of every single sermon that we do now, because we want you to take this beyond this room. So there's passages of scripture on your Connect card that I love for you to read this week. There are things that you can focus on and meditate on. There's a commitment to discuss this teaching with your family, with your friends. I pray you will do those things, because I know what it is to sit in church. I know how easily things go in one ear and out the other. I get it. But I promise you, if you take a step this week to talk about these things, to continue to meditate on them, God's going to root them in your heart. He's going to root his word inside of you. And that's when change begins to take fruit in your life and in your experience. There's also a place there for you to write a prayer request. I would love for you to do that. If you have a need, write it on there. The staff this week, we will lay hands on those cards. We will pray for your request. We will pray that God would deliver you from whatever you're going through. So do that. We want to pray for you. We want to be on the same page with you. When the offering bucket goes by in just a moment, you can put those Connect cards in there so we can receive them and pray with you. And of course, if you're a family member of this church, if this is where you call church home, we thank you for continuing to support innovation, allowing us to do what we do. Thank you so very much. But we're going to go back to God. We're going to have a moment to respond. The band is going to lead us in an incredible song, and it's about surrender. Go figure. And I encourage you, once the offering bucket goes by, to stand, to worship with us. And after we've done that, we're going to go to the Lord's table, and we're going to share communion together. Because it's important to remember, as we surrender all, it's important to remember that Jesus sacrificed all for us. He gave everything for nothing in return. He gave everything for you and for me. So we want to remember that this morning. The ushers are going to come by. Let's continue to worship the Lord together. So, church, we're going to prepare to go to the Lord's table. And as we think of surrender, I just don't think there's something more powerful than to remember when Jesus gave everything for us. So in a moment, the ushers will bring by the bread and the drink. Just so you know, this is simply a reminder. This is a chance for us to remember what Jesus has done for us, to remember his sacrifice on the cross. And he says that if you love me, if you want to know me, if you want a relationship with me, I invite you to this table. And so I invite you. I invite you to the table to remember, to eat and drink and remember his body and his blood. Remember his sacrifice and his love. So the ushers will come by, they'll pass out the bread and the drink. I ask that you would hold on to it. And when I come back, we'll pray and we'll eat and drink together, all right? Let's continue to worship. Thank you, Jesus. It was on the evening that Jesus was to be betrayed, when he gathered his friends, his disciples, to sit around the table and eat with him. And as they were all gathered, he took a loaf of bread and he broke it in his hands and he said, "This is my body." And he passed it to them and said, "You must eat it." And what he meant was that we would partake in the breaking of his body. What he meant was that as his body was broken on the cross, our sin and the things that separate us from a loving God, whatever they are, no matter how great, no matter how bad we might feel, that those things were broken. And in Christ, through his body, we're allowed back into relationship with God the Father. And so, Lord, this morning we remember your sacrifice. We remember your broken body. And holding the bread, holding this reminder, Lord, we say thank you. Thank you, Lord, for what you did on the cross. Thank you for allowing and giving of all of yourself, complete sacrifice for me, for each and every one of your sons and daughters. Lord, we thank you, and we remember your broken body. Church, let's go ahead and eat together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We thank you. Hallelujah. And after they had passed the bread, Jesus took the cup, which was traditionally at that meal called the cup of redemption. But he took it that evening and he repurposed it. He passed it to his disciples and he said, "This wine, this drink, this is my blood." And through it, we receive a fresh start. Through the washing of that blood, through the shedding of his blood on the cross at Calvary, we're allowed to be called holy. And he says, "Enter back into right relationship with me. I see you now clothed in the very righteousness of Jesus." And so today, Lord, we remember your poured out blood. We remember your death on the cross. And again, Lord, we simply say thank you. Without you, we would have nothing. Without you, we would be nowhere. Jesus, we remember your sacrifice this morning. Thank you. Thank you for your love. Church, let's drink together. As you finish, let's continue to worship him. You can raise your voices and just say thank you. Begin to tell him how much you love him. Begin to tell him how much he means to you. Lord, we bless you in this place. You are worthy. You are wonderful. And we're going to continue to worship. We're going to continue to press into God and seek him as we exalt his name on high.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, how we love you, Lord. How we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for your great goodness and kindness to us. Jesus. Oh, God, what great joy. What great joy to surrender to you. What peace, what freedom. We love you. We love you so. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless you. Thank you. Lord, we love you. You're so good. Oh, Jesus, thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, we do love you. We thank you so much for what you're doing in our hearts, for what you're doing in our lives, how you're affecting each and every one of your sons and daughters spread throughout this room. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in all of the families represented here. We thank you, Lord, as you teach us and move us from surrendering some to surrendering all. Lord, draw us up into that freedom. Draw us up into your kingdom to live as you want us to live. Oh, Jesus. And we will be sure. We will be sure in everything we do, in everything we say, to give glory back to your name. The one name that is above all other names, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus, we give you glory here this morning, and we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray all these things in your great name. Amen. Amen. Well, church, listen, we love you guys so very much. I'm so glad that you've been with us today to worship, to receive God's word. I hope that you're not leaving empty, but you're leaving full of the power and the anointing of his Spirit. I just want to tell you, if it's your first time here, we have a gift for you. We've got books as you leave. It's called The Case for Faith. It's a wonderful book. I hope you'll take it. I hope you'll read it. Maybe you're still questioning some of these things. It'll help you out. It's worthwhile. So if it's your first time, we just want to bless you with that. We're so glad that you are here with us today. Church, we love you. I hope you have a wonderful and a blessed week marked by God and his goodness. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you back here, all right? God bless you.